9 matches, 1 championship on the line, 2 different 6-man tag team matches, Zeus, and much more as the World Wrestling Federation presents SummerSlam 1989. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel to help continue growing the brand. Weekly From the Vault episodes every Friday since 2017. If you're a fan of pro wrestling, this is the channel for you. WWF SummerSlam 1989. This show took place on August 28th, 1989, from the Meadowlands Arena in East Rutherford, New Jersey. The reported attendance was 20,000, and the reported pay-per-view buys were 625,000. This was the most bought SummerSlam up until 1998. Your commentators for the night were Jesse Ventura and Tony Schiavone? Yes, you heard that right. Tony Schiavone, the voice of pro wrestling south of the Mason-Dixon line for nearly 20 years, actually called a WWF pay-per-view, and in fact, Tony spent a year in the WWF from WrestleMania V until WrestleMania VI. He did some backstage work at Mania V, called SummerSlam, he called Royal Rumble 1990, and that was it. His final day in the company was April 1st, 1990, though he was not on the WrestleMania 6 show. Initially, Tony was brought into the WWF to replace Gorilla Monsoon on commentary. He would leave the company due to family reasons, though personally, he regretted the decision to leave for years. By all accounts, Tony loved his time in the WWF, and he wished he would have stayed longer. But it is interesting seeing the voice of WCW call a WWF pay-per-view. Even the most die-hard of wrestling fans, they probably forgot Tony spent a year up in New York. SummerSlam 1989 was also the final televised WWF show in the state of New Jersey for 8 years. Coincidentally enough, the next one would be SummerSlam 1997. The reason for it had to do with taxes on televised sporting events, and in the state of New Jersey, pro wrestling was considered a sport. WWF tried to claim that they weren't sport, they were entertainment. This was the infamous New Jersey Senate meeting in February 1989, in which the WWF admitted pro wrestling was a scripted form of entertainment and not legit. Shocking, I know. After wrestling was still considered a part of the tax, WWF stopped televised events taking place in the state. That ended in March 1997 when the then governor of the state put into law that pro wrestling was considered entertainment and not sport. This ensured televised WWF shows would return to the state, and with that, SummerSlam 1997 would happen at the same venue as the 1989 event. It was just under the name Continental Airlines Arena. And with all that out of the way, and after a Dino Bravo Coco Beware Dark match, it's time for the matches of SummerSlam 1989. And we kick things off with match number 1. It was a non-title tag team match. The World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions, the Brainbusters, versus the Hart Foundation. So on Saturday night's main event, 1 month prior to SummerSlam, the Brainbusters won the tag team titles off of Demolition, ending their then-record-setting tag team title reign. The reason for this match at SummerSlam being a non-title match is that in kayfabe, Bobby Heenan contested, the match between the Brainbusters and the Hart Foundation was signed prior to Saturday night's main event, therefore they didn't have to defend the belts at the pay-per-view. So the match would still be happening here at SummerSlam, but it would not be for the WWF Tag Team Championships. This was a hell of an opening match between these two teams, and it was a dream match of sorts. Hearts versus the Horsemen, a match that 1 year earlier seemed like it was never, ever gonna happen, given at that point in time, Arn and Tully were the NWA Tag Team Champions and in a great spot within the promotion. 1 year later, they're in the WWF, and now they're the WWF Tag Team Champions, and this match is taking place. And seeing Tony call an Arn and Tully match in the WWF, it's kind of odd, but also kind of cool. It's like a few years later when JR was calling a Steiner Brothers match at WrestleMania, or when Jesse was calling Rick Rude matches in WCW. Great stuff between these two teams, and this was during the period of time where the WWF was experimenting with the Hart Foundation splitting up. During house shows, both Bret and Anvil would be wrestling singles. Shortly after this, they nearly pulled the trigger on putting both on singles paths. Cooler heads would prevail by the start of 1990. Arn and Tully would pull the old switcheroo during a pin attempt. Arn used Bret's arm to cover his face so the ref didn't see the Busters switching, and in 16 minutes 23 seconds, the Brain Busters picked up the win over the Hart Foundation. Match number 2 was Dusty Rhodes versus the Honky Tonk Man. Dusty had recently debuted with the WWF as the Common Man. He was doing some odd jobs during vignettes, each one ending with somebody saying, "Hey, aren't you?" And at the time, Dusty was feuding with the Big Boss Man. Here at SummerSlam, though, he would be facing Honky Tonk Man. If nothing else, the pre-match promo with Dusty gave us the intro for insane Dusty commentary on Botchamania. The match itself between these two wasn't much of anything, just a way to get Dusty over. Honky Tonk Man, post losing the Intercontinental Championship 1 year earlier at SummerSlam, he had fallen down the card and down the ladder in the company. He was once one of the top heels in the WWF, now in 1989, just fodder for others. Like the first match, it's odd but cool seeing Tony call a Dusty match in the WWF. Jimmy accidentally hit Honky Tonk Man with the guitar, Dusty Rhodes with the win in 9 minutes 36 seconds. Post-match, Honky Tonk Man is in such a daze, he really thinks he's Elvis. He confuses Jimmy Hart and calls him Priscilla. Up next was match number 3, and it was the Red Rooster versus Mr. Perfect. According to legend, both these gimmicks were handed out on the same day, so in an alternate universe, we could have gotten Mr. Perfect Terry Taylor and Kurt Hennig the Red Rooster. Now, when you see the result of the match, you think this was a complete squash of Perfect against Rooster, which made sense. Perfect was on the rise, Rooster was on the fall, and yes, it was. However, it wasn't supposed to be a complete squash. Early on in the match, Rooster injured his knee. He would be out for a month after this, and because of the injury, they had to completely rush to the finish. What was probably gonna be a more competitive match turned into a 3-minute squash, Perfect with the Perfect Plex to continue the Perfect record in 3 minutes 21 seconds. Following that was match number 4, and it was the first of 2 6-man tag team matches on the night. This one was the Rockers and Tito Santana versus the Fabulous Rougeos and Rick Martel. Back at WrestleMania 5, Rick Martel ended Strikeforce with Tito Santana after some miscommunication in their match against the Brainbusters, Rick accidentally getting hit by Tito, and soon after that, Rick abandoned him during the match, and he went backstage to say that when he returned from injury, he didn't want to be in a team anymore, he wanted to be on his own, but Tito Santana wanted to ride his coattails. Rick was the leader of Strikeforce, and now Strikeforce was no more. Meanwhile, the Rockers and the Rougeos had been having a series of matches on the house shows. This right here is a gem in SummerSlam's long history of matches, one of the more underrated matches in show's history. They probably could have gotten rid of one of the matches on this night and split this one into a tag match and a one-on-one match. Because for how big the Strikeforce breakup was, we never got a Tito versus Rick one-on-one pay-per-view match. They were scheduled for SummerSlam the next year, however, Rick had a kayfabe modeling gig. Rockers versus Rougeos on pay-per-view? That would have been outstanding as well. However, combining this into 1 6-man tag worked just as well. This was also during the period of time when Rick was managed by Slick, and this was before Rick was the model. Great stuff here with these 6 wrestlers, the 2 teams. Eventually, Jimmy Hart distracts the referee. You get some back and forth with Marty and Jacques. Rick entered back into the fold because he was the legal man. He pinned Marty, and in 14 minutes 58 seconds, the Rougeos and Rick Martel picked up the win. After that was match number 5. It's the only championship match on this night. This one for the World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Championship. Champion Rick Rude versus challenger The Ultimate Warrior. Rude was in his only reign as the Intercontinental Champion. He defeated Warrior back at WrestleMania 5 to win the belt. These two had been feuding since the start of 1989. You had the Super Pose Down at the Royal Rumble, the aforementioned match at WrestleMania 5 where Rude won the belt. Ever since then, Warrior had been chasing Rude to get his belt back, and the rematch would be here at SummerSlam. Now, you can't talk about this match without talking about the interview that took place earlier in the night, Rick Rude, Bobby Heenan, and Mean Gene. And this here is one of the funniest moments in pro wrestling history, as right when Mean Gene started the interview, gentlemen, as you know, the Ultimate Warrior, the SummerSlam sign fell down. Nice move. Fuck it. And yes, Gene said fuck it and it aired live on pay-per-view. However, this was a taped interview. Mess-ups do happen during these taped interviews, and we've seen a bunch of bloopers happen over the years with these. However, we never saw one happen live on pay-per-view like this, because unfortunately, one of the Einsteiners running production decided they were going to put in the wrong tape. The blooper tape. And the commentators covered it up as best as they could, but how the hell can you cover something like this up? And eventually, they played the regular interview that was supposed to be played in the first place. The blooper has since been removed from SummerSlam 1989 releases. However, because the internet exists, the blooper will live on forever. Now, as far as the match between Warrior and Rude goes, it was a damn good match for the Intercontinental Championship. Warrior had great chemistry with Rude, some of his best matches were with him, and Rude was the kind of guy you didn't want to fuck around with, because Rick Rude is the picture next to the phrase, fuck around and find out. These two are having a really good match. Out comes Roddy Piper. Piper and Rude have been feuding as of late via the Piper-Bobby feud from Primetime Wrestling. Piper mooned Rude. Rude was distracted. That led to Warrior getting the advantage in 16 minutes, 2 seconds. Ultimate Warrior gets the win to become the new Intercontinental Champion. Following that was match number 6. It was the second six-man tag team match of the night. This one, Demolition and King Hacksaw Jim Duggan versus the Triplet Towers, Akeem, Big Boss Man, and the Eiffel Tower, Andre the Giant. And yes, that was the nickname they gave him during the build-up to this match, because you had Andre the Giant teaming up with the Twin Towers, so let's just call him the Eiffel Tower, because France. Duggan and Demolition had been feuding with the Heenan family, of which Andre was a part of. Duggan beat Haku for the crown to become the king, and because of Andre, Demolition lost the tag team titles to the Brainbusters. Jim Duggan, as was tradition back in the day and sometimes during modern day, dressed like his teammates, wore a Demolition mask during his entrance, and he had face paint on during the match. And this match, not really that good at all. Like, you could tell by watching this, there was a reason Andre was more or less forced into wrestling strictly tag matches the rest of his WWF run. 7 minutes, 23 seconds, Demolition and Duggan picked up the win. Up next was match number 7, and it was Hercules versus Greg Valentine. Now, the story here had nothing to do with Greg and Hercules, it had everything to do with Greg and Ronnie Garvin. Those two had been feuding, even leading to Greg defeating Garvin and forcing Garvin into, quote, retirement. Garvin would later do some odd jobs within the company. He was a referee, he was this, he was that. Now he was being a ring announcer here, and throughout Valentine's entire entrance, Ronnie would make fun of Greg anytime he could. The match between Greg and Hercules, it was what it was. Valentine cheated to get the win in 3 minutes 8 seconds. However, when Garvin made the announcement, he declared that Hercules was the winner as far as he was concerned, and Jesse was like, no, no, Greg won the match, and even Tony agreed that, yeah, Valentine won the match. Referee told Ronnie, make the right call, and Garvin was like, okay, okay. The winner of the match, by disqualification, the Mighty Hercules. So twice in a row, Garvin declared Hercules the winner. That led to a post-match fight with Greg and Hercules. Garvin would eventually step in as well. Match number 8, the penultimate match of SummerSlam 1989, was Jimmy Snuka versus Ted DiBiase. This was at the time where Ted was feuding with Jake Roberts. Jake was on the shelf in kayfabe because of Ted. In shoot, it was because he needed to get his neck fixed up. We got Ted versus Snuka here at SummerSlam because, well, they just wanted to get Ted on the show. Not much of a match here. It wasn't great or anything, but it wasn't that terrible either. It was less than 7 minutes, and it was a way to keep Ted looking strong. Ted threw Snuka into the post on the outside of the ring, ref counted to 10, and Ted DiBiase gets the countout win in 6 minutes 27 seconds. With 8 matches down and one more match to go, it's time for match number 9 and the main event of SummerSlam 1989. It was a tag team match. World Wrestling Federation champion Hulk Hogan with Brutus the Barber Beefcake versus Randy Savage and Zeus. The Hogan-Savage feud was still going on after WrestleMania V. Elizabeth had left Savage. Savage got a new manager. That was Sensational Sherry. You would think they would have done a title rematch between Hogan and Savage here at SummerSlam, but instead of doing a title rematch, they decided to incorporate the No Holds Barred movie into things. WWF filmed the movie No Holds Barred that starred Hogan. It was released in June 1989, and the WWF decided to bring in Tiny Lister, who played Zeus in the movie, to be Zeus in the ring. The story being that Zeus was there to settle things with Hogan, quote, in real life and not a movie. So this was the movie character trying to get revenge on the man who played his opponent in said movie. So Tiny Lister had zero wrestling experience prior to this endeavor because, well, he was an actor. Basically what they did here was have him do his Zeus stuff from No Holds Barred in the ring, be a menacing monster like he was in the movie. To keep him calm, Hogan and Beefcake used the phrase Free James Brown, which apparently was a quote that amused Lister enough to keep him calm during the match, and it was a phrase that was apparently also used during the filming of No Holds Barred a year earlier. Elizabeth returned here to be in the corner of Hogan and Beefcake. All things considered, this main event was as good as it was gonna be. You at least had Savage in there to be the worker to work the bulk of the match for his team, where Zeus would come in and do his thing every now and then. Now, some will question Beefcake being Hogan's partner. Well, A, he was Hogan's best friend, of course he was going to be in this spot. And B, even if he wasn't, Brutus Beefcake in 1989 was over just enough as a babyface that he warranted the spot in this match. Honestly, who else would you have had in that spot other than Beefcake? Because Warrior was in the Intercontinental Championship match, Jake was injured, so maybe Duggan? Like, who really else at that kind of top singles babyface level would you have put in there? Honestly, Beefcake was fine in that spot. Eventually, near the end, Hogan hit Zeus with Sherry's purse. He no-sold it. Hogan with the body slam, the leg drop, it was over. In 15 minutes, 4 seconds, the team of Hulk Hogan and Brutus Beefcake pick up the win. SummerSlam 1989 is a mixed bag of a show. There's some really good stuff on here. The opening Brainbusters Hart Foundation match, that's the golden ring bell for best match of the night, that was phenomenal. You also had the Tito Martel 6-man tag match that was really good. The Intercontinental title match was damn good. And even the main event, for what it was solid. Then, of course, you had the not-so-good stuff on the card, specifically the other 6-man tag with Andre in it, the brown ring bell for worst match of the night. And there's a lot of sort of matches in there as well, but if you've never seen SummerSlam 1989 before, I do suggest checking it out to say that you've seen all the SummerSlams, and that way you can form your own opinion on the show. And I've also shared my opinions on a lot of other SummerSlams from the past, so click the card for those episodes. Also click the card for other WWE pay-per-view reviews and click the archive card for other great From the Vault episodes. Peace.